So Paul, we're having this conversation because you just recently put out a film, Why Is There Nothing to Watch on YouTube? And it really kind of hit a nerve for me, this sense. And then we did a live event on Monday with our community that we called Narrative Collapse around that question, just to kind of invite the community and have a discussion around this sense of where, for me, what really resonated was this feeling of having followed an emergent and interesting conversation, starting with Jordan Peterson, going into sort of the intellectual dark web, and then looking at what are the new and interesting voices, and sort of feeling like that trail had run cold a little bit. And your piece, just even the title of it, to be honest, really named it. And then you unpacked in it the sort of the wider meaning crisis, the sense of kind of narrative exhaustion that I think a lot of us are maybe feeling. And I really wanted to have an exploratory, continue the discussion that we started on Monday and put it out on the channel. Invite people who are watching this to maybe kind of contribute in the comments and start this kind of, yeah, just explore this topic that you've obviously been thinking about as well at the same time. Do you want to maybe start by talking about what you meant by that piece and where you feel that, how you're seeing the kind of wider conversation at the moment?
I talked about the fact that you and I sort of got into the space at the same time. You came from journalism. I've been a local church pastor for a long time. We both were excited, and not just by the work of Jordan Peterson directly, but by the response to it. And that was a signal that something significant was happening in the culture. Something significant was happening around him. I think both you and I shared the impression that, you know, we weren't quite sure where this would go. And of course, Eric Weinstein, you know, came up with this name, Intellectual Dark Web. A few other characters sort of came along in the cluster, and the New York Times did a piece on them. And there was the sense that, oh, okay, well, maybe this is going someplace. Ryan Bennett had that, you know, a term that you've mentioned a number of times, the, you know, IDW protocol. I mean, there seemed to be a lot of momentum, and that momentum, I think, has really stalled. And you've named this in a number of the pieces that you've done, and I've really appreciated that. The video that I did last week came out of a meetup group when I, you know, basically someone just said, you know, I can't find anything to watch. YouTube is boring now. YouTube didn't used to be boring. And I had heard a number of people in from different places say very different, you know, say very similar things. I can't find any podcasts that hold my interest. At night, often after the day, I'll sit down on the couch with my wife, catch up, and we might watch something on TV, and, you know, everything's streamed now. And I just watch her going through, you know, page after page of Netflix things. And I'm watching this thinking, we've got more content than ever before to watch. And why does nothing grab us? So I thought about that. And so I made the video, and there are a number of, COVID has something to do with it. I think your themes about sense-making are important. And that wasn't really a language that I was used to using, but as I've watched a number of the things on your channel, you know, sort of understanding how we, mass media sort of produced a mass monoculture. And now we've got these massive questions before us, you know, how to respond to a pandemic, you know, was the American election stolen or not stolen? You know, how do we regard climate change? We have these massive questions, and there's no singular voice. And then with your Monday meeting, that really prompted me to think about how similar a lot of the stuff that you're doing, maybe not simply with the videos that you're releasing, saw a taste of it with the video that you had with Jonathan Peugeot and John Vervaeke, but you're doing, you know, collective cognition is one way to talk about it, but you're doing meaning making within a community. And as a pastor, that's in many ways what churches have always been. And then churches, of course, structure out into denominations and things like that. And so that really made me think about why a lot of the IDW let's say, thought leaders like Eric Weinstein and Brett Weinstein. I'd done a video a couple of weeks ago, basically about how I've sort of feel like I've heard enough of Eric and Brett on a lot of topics. And why is that? Why isn't it fresh? And I think it has something to do with punditry. And why I think when I listen to you, you're always in your channel, you're always looking for new signals. But I think a big piece of that is because you're also developing community. And that community is not only a function of, let's say, cultural change, which Eric and Brett are very focused on, but that community for you is also basically, that's your antenna for the signals, and it acts as a filter. So I pondered a lot of those things, and my experience with your group Monday sort of reinforced that for me.
There was a few things that really came out of that call on Monday, one of which that I really resonated with was this sense of almost that we'd reach the limits of the individual. And Adriana, I think, that came up in one of the groups and was shared with the main group, and it really resonated because in a way, Jordan Peterson was like, you could look at it as almost like the last gasp of the heroic individual based around individualism. And I've always, like, I've come to kind of reflect on that and think, like, what Peterson's message was bringing was absolutely necessary, but not sufficient. Like, you can't bypass the work of the individual. You can't bypass the work of really looking at our resentments, of really kind of looking at how we embody truth in our lives, all of that work. And that's absolutely core before you go beyond. But there is, I think, a place where we go beyond, and that place of community is that beyond. And then also what I was reflecting on was this sense of seeing people that I used to feel had some novel perspective becoming increasingly crystallized around, and often it's crystallized around poor thinking, it's crystallized around their personality structure, and I see that happening in real time on Twitter. Like, you see, and it's almost like the bigger the Twitter following you have, the more exposed you are, the more you can see these boundaries being policed of thought and of tribalism on Twitter. And I see people who I enormously respect, like Brett, for example, writing off people that I think have valid critique or could have valid critique, and they're people being reactive. And I think Twitter itself starts becoming part of this, and this sense of, I'm sort of just extemporizing at the moment, this sense of that because what social media does is it's an uncanny way of creating a filter bubble around us, of triggering our worst impulses, of basically emphasizing our narcissism, our defensiveness, our thin-skinnedness, all these things, that it basically forms, it's an accelerator of these patterns of defensiveness and lack of curiosity, or it acts against curiosity, which is something that Tristan Harris said in our interview, where he said, what it does is it just shows you more of what you already think. It blocks you off from any new, because there's an infinite amount of things that will just prove that you were right all along. And I saw this, I feel like the intellectual dark web, loosely said as a structure, was a kind of insurgency, a counterpoint to what felt like an already kind of moribund mainstream narrative. But it also then, almost as soon as it was named, became a thing itself, stopped evolving to any great degree, and then became, it died, because it wasn't dark. As soon as it was named, as soon as it was identified, it became a thing, and then it became subject to a lot of those same forces, which I know I've put that to Eric and to Brett directly, and they would disagree with that, but I think that's true. Those are a few thoughts, but they were some that came up in the session on Monday, and some that maybe I've just expressed for the first time. What are you seeing? Because we're outside this. We're not actually players in this, which allows us to maybe have a different perspective.
Well, I think you hit on something there, which is important. I mean, you and I are right now talking over Zoom. We do a lot of work on YouTube. We're on Twitter, but each of us inhabit these environments as a persona. And so Twitter is going to shape that persona. Part of what I think we saw with Jordan Peterson, and I really love the way you phrased it, sort of the last gasp of the individual, we saw a capacity in YouTube for something that I hadn't imagined. I hadn't done anything on YouTube. It was a place for silly videos or to watch a movie trailer. And so Jordan Peterson sort of opened my eyes to the possibility of what YouTube might be. But each of these contexts, you inhabit the context as a persona, and that persona is going to feed back on you. We talked also in your Monday meeting about the, about not only the financial structures and getting into the, that excellent piece, The Internet of Beefs, where you have this mooks and knights dynamic where, the persona in that medium is what gathers the audience. In churches, we have this saying, what you catch them with, you catch them too, which means that persona, people hear you talking about the woke stuff and they felt some annoyance, and then they hear this language that suddenly makes sense of the annoying HR department at work, they gravitate towards it. And then they feed off of it for a while until they're so sort of satiated. And then, okay, what's on next? And so the dynamic between the persona and the context, I think, is vital here. And also so if you listen to Brett and Eric and see Jordan, in a sense, wanted to save the individual. And that was very different about his mission. And that was also something very powerful about it. But very quickly, Eric and Brett's mission have tended to focus on the political. And so you'll get the same persona environment dynamic in that. And I think once it goes there, you lose a lot of the longevity and richness. Whereas what I see you doing, again, especially what I saw Monday in that meeting, was you're less of a persona in that group. Again, as a pastor, I have the persona of a pastor in a church, so I inhabit that partly, and that impacts it. But in the kind of community you're developing, you're going to get a far richer, broader, multifaceted persona and allow others to do as well. And that's going to diminish some of the inherent problems in a platform like Twitter, and also diminish the sort of one-dimensional political aspect. And again, when I look at what's happening, when you become a political pundit, now that environment is going to hit the persona, and in a sense, you're going to be trapped by it.
You mentioned the Internet of Beefs there, and I think if people haven't seen that, maybe we'll bring up a screenshot now, the article by Venkatesh Rao. It names that really well, because it basically says this is how you win at that game of personas, of persona online. And actually, I look at some people who play that game incredibly well. Someone like Candace Owens, for example, who kind of becomes a cartoon version of a certain perspective. It really, really works. I look at James Lindsay and the way that his Twitter following has grown massively. And he admitted, I had an interview with him where I actually challenged him because he'd written a book about how to have impossible conversations. And a lot of people had pointed out, well, that's not how you're not modeling that on Twitter. And he said, yeah, Twitter's a game. Twitter's basically a game, which I actually disagree with. I think you're basically perpetuating that dynamic if you play it that way. So if you do bad faith opponents, if you do what the Internet of Beef say, which I think James has done, he's been doing this increasingly, and I think a lot of people have seen it, but his followership has grown. And I don't want to dismiss him. I think he does really incredible work, But I think even his friends, I'm sure, are saying behind the scenes, look, James, your Twitter persona is not helpful to kind of persuading anyone who's not already on your side. But it works. And it's in the computer game of social media, the source code, it seems, is kind of irredeemably broken and forces us to become cartoon versions of ourselves, no matter how much we may try to avoid it. And I'm sure YouTube does that as well. I mean, it sort of seems to be the process of, it seems to be built into the tools that we have at the moment, and maybe is built into the whole process. I don't know. What do you want to extemporize a little bit on that?
Well, when we look at, let's say, the Dunbar number, so 150 is about the extent to which one human being can have a, let's call it a 360 degree embodied relationship with a number of other people. Part of what we do on these platforms, and this is very old, you do it through books, it's not just electronic media, but part of what we do is we sort of fracture ourselves, and we can use Harry Potter, we sort of create these little horcrux personas that operate in these environments. And we do this in order to scale, and we do it in order to scale, and then of course you monetize it, and all of those things begin to bind in on you and begin to, you have to become this persona. And you see this in the political sphere. What happens though in a real life community is that you get to know not just the persona. And again, we all have that dynamic in any, even in real life meat space communities. You get to know that persona, but you get to know the person beyond the persona. And all of that other information, that's local knowledge, that then begins to, I think, reduce certain hierarchies and certain elements of corruption. I remember Eric Weinstein commenting about Ben Shapiro, because he said, Ben Shapiro, and obviously politically, Eric Weinstein and Ben Shapiro are not on the same page, but Eric Weinstein and Ben Shapiro can be friends. But he says, it's the character that you play on YouTube, and it's the thing that you do with Daily Wire. Where I came to this was, this is both important in terms of a signal reception in meaning making and sense making, because we need to know, we're looking to know how to fully inhabit this too complex space for us to manage. And so we have to do that with heuristics and shortcuts and tracks and hacks. But in order to do that, we want to see a fuller image. And so again, what I see when I look at, I was watching a bunch of Brett stuff, and then I found the Game B stuff, which I think I found that through your channel, the Game B stuff. And so I dug down into some of that. And then I thought, how has the world changed before? Because that's what they're looking at. They're trying to save the world. Well, some of the greatest world changers happened centuries before. We didn't have any of this electronic medium. Socrates, for example, only his disciples wrote about him. Same with Jesus. Jesus never wrote a book. The stuff we have of Siddhartha Gautama, were written by his disciples. Generally speaking, small groups of people were able to inhabit and flesh an archetype or a series of archetypes and certain patterns, and they lived in that community. And those things spread. Now, that's a very slow process, but it's faster than you might think. And so to me, when I watch people being pundits, I think that's kind of a change the world quick scheme that probably isn't going to go very deep, because what we're really talking about is people only make sense in communities. And so if you really want to develop your sense making, you must both participate in community and form it. And, you know, I was just listening to a podcast with Sam Harris on yesterday, and that came up again. Oh, we need community. Okay. Well, what's that going to require? It's going to require you being much less a Twitter persona. But people don't have patience for that. But I think it's foolish, because the kind of, when I see what you're doing with your group, I look at that and say, yeah, I really recognize that. Because that's how the world has changed, often for the better, for all of recorded human history.
Yeah, and I wouldn't want to kind of overpromise that. I mean, that's definitely what we're intending with the community. I think we're still, all of us who are in this space are still experimenting with what that looks like, especially virtually. I mean, my friend Peter Lindberg at the Stoa is doing something really interesting as well. It's a process of, we're sort of feeling our way through right now. And I wouldn't say that every session we do has that quality. I thought that session on Monday was particularly good. There was a real sense of some real gems being emerging from that process that sort of certainly felt like it was pushing forward into the question. And there are all of these, and that's, I'm interested in the parallels as well, because I know that church has, I was speaking to, I don't think it was you, I think it was someone else, where we were saying, oh yeah, we do this or we do that on our retreats. And someone said, oh yeah, well that's small group. And then we said, well, we stand up in front of the group and we talk about, we kind of basically expose or share kind of our vulnerability. And it's like, yep, that's what we do that. And it was interesting, the parallels that were sort of coming through. And one more thing I'd like to say as well is another parallel that I was not aware of before listening to Jordan Peterson was that Carl Rogers, who was the inventor of person-centered therapy in the 50s, which was kind of rebellion against. So before we had Freud and we had Jung and we had these very kind of maybe elaborate ideas and structures that Freud came up with, like the id and the ego and the Oedipal complex and all these like very elaborate things. And Carl Rogers pretty much came along and said, you don't need that. Person-centered counseling is, we all know what we need. There is a healing instinct within each person, and that's through speaking truth and aligning ourselves to truth. And that's where person-centered counseling came from. I didn't realize that he was an evangelical Christian. And that was actually a process of kind of embodying the logos. And that sense of kind of embodied truth and speaking truth and the healing power of that and the necessity of that is right at the core of this as well, I think, in part of these, in these processes.
Yeah. Well, and I think, you know, when I saw Jordan doing what he was doing, I was reminded of evangelistic crusades, where someone gets up on a stage, has a life-transforming message, people take it in, have an immediate sense. But one of the things that churches learned was you can have that experience, but what you're actually going to need is a whole lot more processing. And it isn't, you know, there's not enough money or time or education to deploy counselors to all these people. I mean, there's counseling profession is out there. I learned as a minister that mostly what helped people was to sit there and be with them and listen to them. And so then the question is, how can you establish a culture where people can come in and talk and listen, learn to listen, learn to care, be present with one another, and then, well, how do you scale this up? Well, you can't do it over YouTube. You have to do it in smaller spaces, and they have to be more stable. And, you know, just what you said about, well, Monday's meeting went forward. Talk to any pastor, at least, and they'll tell you. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But part of part of learning how this goes is, okay, when you have a bad session or when you have a bad gathering, you don't quit. You come back again and you try again. And you might not be able to gain an insight as to why it went bad that you can sort of with one part of your brain that you can write down in a sentence, but another part, the rest of your brain has sort of probably figured that out. And over time, what happens is that the community begins to know how to, and I mean, you guys have all these, you know, collective cognition. That's sort of a fancy way of people being together and learning to do healthy things or sometimes unhealthy things together. And I think that's actually how the world is changed and how societies are created. Now, bad things can be reproduced or good things can be reproduced, but that's when you're going to start getting into, okay, what's the symbolism? What are the hierarchies? What are the, you know, who are the heroes that we are emulating? What are the practices? But I think the process of all of that is community. It's talking, and there's a place for messaging, but it's all of that other stuff underneath where people really change.
Yeah, there's a few things that come up. One is the transformative power of truth, which is something that I think Jordan Peterson spoke to really beautifully. I remember, I think it was on the Joe Rogan podcast, he talked about kind of allowing the dead wood to burn off, that process of realizing that we're talking bullshit, like maybe 95% of what you say is actually bullshit, and beginning that process of really kind of aligning with what is true, that I think really resonated with a lot of people. And the difficulty of doing that, like the people we mentioned before, like say the intellectual dark web folks or anyone with a public profile, it's really hard to do that. It's really hard to do that in public. It's really hard when there's not even a culture where you're even allowed to make those mistakes in public and to say stuff that is, it feels like, in some ways, the state of, apart from a few examples, the state with which you, like, we don't see a lot of growing up in public, apart from like very, very specific scandals or examples. And it feels like the very nature of that process of becoming celebrated for something that you've done or something that you've thought, or becoming that kind of public intellectual or player in that game, militates against that process happening. It's very difficult then to reflect, partly because I think you've got success for some of your flaws as much as some of your successes. But there's also this sense of that crystallization process, or that fixation process comes in. And then there's the fact that in a way now, we're all famous in some way. Like we're all well known we're all part of different Facebook groups where we're known. Like we're all now public figures in some strange way to one, like within our own world. It just depends kind of what network. So we're all part of that process. And I see everyone. Yeah, I've been shocked to see how, and that corrupt sense making at a very deep level. And I've been shocked to see how many people have crystallized around nonsense over the last, and I've seen it accelerate over the last 4 years as well. Like people who were sort of probably heterodox thinkers a while ago drift further and further into like conspiratorial nonsense, or start with a perspective of, well, Trump is a necessary evil to kind of the liberal consensus, which is sort of looking down its nose at the rest of the at most of America, and like I'm on board with that. And now suddenly they're like, no, every bad thing you hear about Trump is just the liberal media, and it's like denying the obvious evidence of everyone's eyes that this is a not a guy to be admired, whether or not he's playing a particular role. Like, I'd seen no one able to hold this center ground of being able to sort of see reality clearly, but all without falling to one side or the other of just insanity, whether that's completely accepting the mainstream narrative or whether that's completely rejecting the mainstream narrative. Like, it just walking that razor's edge has just seemed to be getting more and more difficult over the last, certainly over the last 4 years. And now I kind of count on the fingers of one hand the number of people I think that are able to do it, that are able to see things clearly.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, in that sense, again, the persona and the platform, I mean, families are like that. When, you know, you grow up in this family and everybody has their role and the family kind of doesn't let them out of their role. And what we've created in this media space is sort of the same thing. And so Trump now has to play a role for people. And so when they're either they can't critique or they're all critique, you know, it's either Trump derangement or Trump adoration. It's because, again, Trump is playing a role in them. It's the persona that's acting. And we see, you know, think about Bill and Hillary Clinton. You know, Bill Clinton in his presidency has this dramatic, you know, affair public with Monica Lewinsky. They stay married. How does that work? We'll never know. And partly we shouldn't know because their marriage is, you know, a foreign country to all of us, as every marriage is. But at the same time, part of what we have happening is that people are forced to play roles, and we, just like a family, keep them in those roles. The problem is if we continue to imagine that this is real life, that dynamic, very unhealthy dynamic, is going to be accentuated within us and between us. And, you know, I think, you know, part of what John Vervaeke has really contributed to all of this is, you know, the four P's of knowledge. Well, there's proposition, there's propositional, but there's also perspectival and participatory and procedural. And so, again, part of what we're going to have to do is, and I think this is part of probably what our bodies are telling us, you can't find anything good on TV or YouTube, maybe it's time to turn it off. Maybe it's time to, you know, I know we've got COVID right now, and so we're all sort of boxed in, but maybe it's time to do something with your hands. Maybe it's time to, you know, have a full conversation with a person that you know who's actually embodied and it's not mediated by a screen. And so, you know, I think we should take these moments and learn from them and say, okay, well, what are we learning about these new tools that are disabling us, even as they enable some really dramatic things? And then also, okay, how do we need to, if we're recognizing the persona platform dynamic, how do we need to, you know, how do we need to operate in these personas? And maybe it means, you know, saying, I'm sorry, I'm wrong, giving, and this again is something that you spoke quite clearly about the IDW. I've changed my mind about this, or I'm open to listening to you. And, you know, maybe we need more videos of people listening rather than just talking.
I feel like, as you said, that we should probably be turning off YouTube. This is probably where we should finish the conversation. But I don't want to cut. I don't want to finish before, because I know you've been thinking about this for a few days. So I just wanted to make sure you get the chance to express anything else that you haven't yet.
You know, so I do a lot of talking on YouTube. You know, my videos go on a long, long time. But in my meetup space, in the Discord server, and then in, you know, as a guest in your space, I found, you know, I came into your space and just listening to a whole bunch of the different opinions, you know, there's some, you know, really remarkable and brilliant people in your community. And I could see their brilliance and their, you know, their quality just in those little interactions. And they're also, you know, they're also wounded and vulnerable and imperfect and annoying and boring, all those. I mean, we are all those things. Mm-hmm. And so I just, you know, I think you're exactly right in when we go into a place like Twitter, which is not a neutral platform, we have to actively probably try to counteract the implicit slant of that platform and probably go out of our way to be generous to our rivals and adversaries and admit when we're wrong and be, you know, resist. You know, the family wants to keep you as you were when you were 8 years old. Well, that's on their side, but you don't have to act like an eight-year-old, which is often what happens when the family treats you like the eight-year-old. You respond like an eight-year-old, and the whole thing just gets reinforced. And so I think we should continue to figure out how to use these tremendously powerful, really remarkable tools that have come online to us in the last just few years and figure out, okay, how can we love our enemies through them and not just reinforce really bad habits that we know in lots of other ways too.
Hmm. Yeah, there was one thing that I wanted to say before we conclude, and that's something maybe we've talked about before, but I certainly felt like this huge missed opportunity of the intellectual dark web movement as a sort of the name of a heterodox movement that could have grown bigger and integrated more perspectives than it ended up doing. And I really felt it at the time as a potential, it could have become more of a grassroots movement. And it never really did. And I feel there's a few reasons for that, partly because I think it was quite an intoxicating thing for the people who were part of it. There was this whole dynamic at the beginning with they were doing like these very high profile events with Pangburn. There was this sense of, and maybe they were mostly focused on the sort of public facing aspect of that. But there really felt like there could have been a much more ground up discussion. There could have been a more, partly capitalizing on this, on the success of Jordan Peterson, the success of this sense of intellectuals as the new rock stars, ideas being something that are now have real currency, Sam Harris, Jordan Peterson selling at massive arenas, this sense of, oh wow, is this the new thing? Is intellectual debate the new rock music or new comedy or whatever? And that, and the fact that that never, there was never seemingly any way of turning that into a broader movement that everyone could join was a real absence. I think was a real sense that I think a lot of people, it could have been. There was a moment where it could have been more of a grassroots thing, and maybe it's not too late for that, but that really felt like a missed opportunity at the time.
I agree. That's part of why I started making videos. But I think we have to be aware of speed. We have to be aware of haste. We have to be aware of size. And when we say rock star, I mean, rock stars wind up in rehab, right? And the only ones that see their 60s or 70s are the ones that go through rehab. That's, you know, that's what the system does. And, you know, we think it'll only do it to, you know, high school basketball and football players and musicians. No, it'll do it to intellectuals. We've all got the same wiring, the same limbic system. And so and you know, I think if Eric and Brett and others want to change the world, you know, be a friend of small, be a friend of slow, be a friend of patient. And that's actually the way the world changes for good. And because people are organic. We change slowly. We talk a lot, but we don't really change.
Some of us do, Paul.
What's that?
Some of us do, Paul.
Well, you are a good listener. And again, I do want to say that, you know, we've only been, I mean, Jordan Peterson's rise was October of 2016 when he started complaining about C16. That's, we say, oh, wow, that's 4 years ago. It's not much time. And I really appreciate the honesty with which you've, the honesty and doggedness with which you've pursued these questions. And almost always when you read history, the people we look back on and say, wow, they were crucial and instrumental, you almost always find around them a whole constellation of people who were big at their time and now forgotten, but then a whole nother constellation of role players. I mean, Michael Jordan would not have been Michael Jordan without Scottie Pippen and Dennis Rodman and, you know, all of these individuals. And we tend to remember sort of the blips, but that's the way the world changes, and we shouldn't forget it.
And Jerry Krause as well.
That's right. Absolutely.
That's an in-joke for anyone who's watched the Michael Jordan documentary, but probably no one else will get. Yeah. No, this has been great, Paul. As always, it's always a pleasure to talk to you. And yeah, I want to also echo like what you've been doing. Yeah, the curiosity, because you've come from an obviously sort of religious background, but you really wanted to have dialogues across what you might call the divides. But I think you've shown a real desire to sort of follow the curiosity and the truth wherever it goes. Talking with John Bavakey, talking with others in this space who are kind of trying to kind of wrestle with these big questions as well.
Well, it's my pleasure. And again, I just want to encourage you to keep doing what you're doing.
Rebel Wisdom isn't only about the ideas in the films. It's also about how we bring them into our lives, which is why over the last few months, we've invested in developing the Rebel Wisdom community, our digital campfire. We've launched a new platform for discussion and connection, started regular meetups and practice sessions for members, plus Q&As with some of the amazing interviewees we've had on the channel, and our Wisdom Gym with some of the biggest names in growth and transformation. So if you'd like to support Rebel Wisdom to help us continue to make films and to find the others, maybe think about joining the Rebel Wisdom community. Thank you for watching.